Hi everybody. So I decided to make this video. I'm calling Coronavirus. Why are we doing what we're doing? The reason I decided to make this video is because one thing we're seeing is a ton of skepticism among people about why the public health response in the US is what it is. And a lot of questioning, like we don't do this stuff for the flu. Why are we doing it for the coronavirus? And so there's a lot of great information out there from really official sources, CDC, WHO, state health departments, etc., that cover this topic, as well as just a lot of people who are talking about it, healthcare professionals, just everyday people. A lot of what I've seen is in written form. Some of it's pretty technical. So I figured I'd make this video that tries to explain why are we doing what we're doing in as simple of terms as possible. Really quickly, who am I? So my name's Phil Smith. I have a master's degree in epidemiology and a PhD in community health and health behavior, both from SUNY Buffalo. I did some postdoctoral training in epidemiology and biostatistics at Yale University, as well as some research in their medical school. And then I've taught for a couple years epidemiology and biostatistics at the CUNY School of Medicine in New York. And that included teaching infectious disease epidemiology, right, to future doctors. And now I'm a public health professor at Miami of Ohio. And I do public health research. I work with, local health departments on some issues. So I'm in the process of making videos for my classes that are now going to online or remote access. And so I figured why not make this video too? So the first really important thing to understand is this idea of R-naught. So it's actually a very, very simple concept that's really easy to wrap your head around. So it's the idea that if you get sick with some kind of viral infection, for example, how many people are you likely to get sick, right? So on average, if someone gets sick from a particular virus or whatever it is, infectious disease, on average, how many people will that person spread the virus to, right? Pretty straightforward. So a couple of numbers here right off the bat. The typical influenza, that number is about 1.2. So everybody that gets sick with the flu on average spreads it to about one other person. And that's typical influenza, right? There's a ton of variability in terms of different strains of influenza. But for a point of comparison, we're talking about like a typical influenza. That number for COVID-19, based on the best estimates, is two. So instead of spreading to one person, like for the flu, every person that get sick with the coronavirus tends to spread it to two people. There's a lot of factors that go into it that actually we don't really need to get into in order to explain why we're doing what we're doing for COVID-19. Another idea that you've been seeing, and you're seeing this visually displayed in these epidemic curves that people are circulating, is this idea of exponential spread. People are talking about COVID-19 and exponential transmission, exponential spread. So I figured I'll make a little visual that helps solidify this idea of exponential spread. And it's related to this idea of R-naught and how many people a typical person spreads the virus to. So here we have a person with the flu and a person with COVID-19. The person with the flu spreads it to one person. The person with coronavirus spreads it to two people. That new person with the flu spreads it to one more person, and each of those two new people with coronavirus spread it to two more people. So off to the right, you see our total tally of people with each of the virus. Now, we're just gonna watch this, and it's the same process. So hopefully you saw very quickly how it gets out of hand for COVID-19 versus what you see with the flu. I'm kind of running out of space in my slides and I've been hitting copy and paste a lot of times. So I think you kind of get the point here. This is just a little visual depiction of our healthcare capacity, right? So the boxes are healthcare capacity. Inside it, we have X's, which are sick people. And our healthcare system operates pretty near capacity on a typical basis. And We can expand that capacity a little bit, but if you ask healthcare professionals, they work really hard and they're kind of pushed their limit as is. So oversimplification, but we're pretty close to operating to capacity. Now, what's important to say about this is our capacity includes anticipation of influenza and all the other illnesses. We have a typical demand for healthcare services, and our healthcare system is, met to meet that demand, of course, excluding, people who don't get healthcare and all those kinds of things. But where we have a capacity, we're kind of operate at that capacity, and that capacity includes and accounts for influenza. Now, sometimes when there's a particularly bad year of influenza, for example, we start to see that capacity stretched in our hospital system. But generally, our healthcare system is meant to meet our capacity with a little bit of flexibility. So there's a little bit of room for growth when there's a little bit of extra need for capacity. So what happens then when you unexpectedly see all these new cases of coronavirus? Some of them, a lot of them are relatively severe, who need treatment. We're already at capacity, and now we have in any given community where there's an outbreak, we could have all these new cases of people that need treatment. And so if that happens too fast, right, we're going to exceed capacity really quickly, right? This is what you're seeing happen in some other countries right now. It's massively exceeding capacity. And so this isn't just people with coronavirus who are going to be sick and not be able to get the treatment they need, right? These are going to be people with all sorts of conditions who need access to healthcare and aren't able to get it, even if they can afford it, right? That's an issue in itself. But even if they can afford it, they're not going to be able to get it because we're going to be way, that we could run into a situation where we're way beyond the capacity that we have to treat people. So everything the public health professionals, agencies, public health community is doing right now is trying to slow things down, spread things out, right? So we don't have this massive influx, sudden influx of extra sick people in our healthcare system, so that we don't massively exceed our healthcare system capacity, so that we have some people, extra people who are sick, we can take care of these people. We have some more people who are sick, we can take care of those people. Also, so that our healthcare system can expand gradually, because expanding a healthcare system takes time, right? So we can expand to meet the need as it comes up. But all of that requires that all of this transmission slows down. Now, this idea of slowing down the rate of the spread of this the coronavirus is also really good for the economy, relatively speaking, right? So you can imagine a situation where we don't do anything, right? We don't cancel events, we don't tell everybody to wash their hands, we don't do any of this stuff. And then all of a sudden, like in the picture before, we have this massive influx of sick people from coronavirus, in addition to an already, stretched capacity in our healthcare system. What does that do to the economy? Think about that for a second, right? It's going to, everybody, people are going to panic, right? So all these events and things, canceling, school shutting down, like that's going to happen anyways, right? All this stuff's going to happen anyways. People are going to stay home anyways, or try to if they can. And so that economic impact would also happen really fast. And when those economic changes happen really fast, that's when we get into serious crisis mode. So if this outbreak happens, just to summarize this, make this point again really quickly, if this outbreak happens and we're not doing anything to slow it down, the economic changes could be much worse and much faster, right? So what slowing down the virus spread does, we're also trying to gradually and very judiciously close things down, encourage people to stay home, so that we're controlling as much as we can the economic effects. So the public health community is getting a lot of criticism for making these decisions that have a negative impact on the economy and the stock market and all that kind of the stock market falling and all that kind of stuff. And public health community is getting criticized for this. But what they're really trying to do, again, is slow the rate of this economic change so that the economy can adjust as best it can in still a really short amount of time, but also so that all these changes, right, and the negative economic impact doesn't happen chaotically or all at once. The public health community is trying to give people time to plan. Right, planning makes a huge difference for businesses as well as for individuals and families. Right, so public health community is getting criticized for what they're doing to affect the economy, but what they're actually trying to do is avoid an even greater economic crisis. So everything you need to know about why the public health community, public health agencies are doing what they're doing is already explained, and it's pretty simple. But I'm seeing a lot of people trying to compare mortality rates between flu and coronavirus and justifying or thinking about, like, why are we doing what we're doing with the, you know, comparing these different mortality rates. It's actually not that helpful to think about things this way. And one of the reasons is that people are conflating terminology left and right. So in epidemiology, we have, like, your mortality rate, which is very simply, the percent of people who get sick with something who die from that something. So the percent of people who get influenza who die from influenza, for example. Then we have something else called case fatality, which is the percent of confirmed cases who die. So obviously we know not everybody who gets sick with something, for example, coronavirus, gets tested. And so these are two completely different things. And what we're seeing is that people are throwing out this number for influenza, which is actually mortality. It's at the 0.1% that we're seeing is an estimate of mortality. So among everybody who gets sick, what are the percent who end up dying? That's the best estimate. And it's, again, typical, right? Different flus, different mortality rates. The number we're seeing for COVID-19, around 3%, give or take a few decimal places, that's a case fatality rate. And case fatality rate is affected by all sorts of things that determine who gets tested and who doesn't get tested. So you're comparing apples to oranges already. So it's for that reason in itself, not that helpful to do. But if you understand what I already explained in terms of, yeah, a good portion of people who get coronavirus, could create a lot of sick people and a lot of deaths. And you think about what that does to the healthcare system, you don't really need to compare and contrast death rates to understand why we're doing what we're doing. Now, people want to know, like, how much at risk am I? How much at risk are people that I care about? And so you can think about mortality rates and things like that if that's helpful for you. And thinking about who's most vulnerable, who's most vulnerable, who's at greatest risk. But in terms of understanding the public health response, it's actually not that relevant. And when you're thinking about it in terms of your own self, really try to understand, what are they talking about? Are they talking about an estimate of mortality? Or are they talking about case fatality? And what's the difference between those two things? Now, I wouldn't be a very good public health person if I didn't take this opportunity to encourage people to do all the things that everybody else is already encouraging you to do. So this includes staying informed from official sources, not just what's showing up on your Facebook feed, but staying informed from your local health department, your state health department. In Ohio, our state health department has a hotline number. You can call with questions and concerns, but obviously websites, the CDC puts a ton of information out there on their website. So stay informed from official sources. Media is helpful, but again, media is the media. So I encourage everybody to go straight to the source for this kind of thing. Follow those recommendations coming from your official sources. Hopefully I've made enough of a point to explain why these recommendations are what they are. So it's up to us to try to follow them as best we can. And that includes all the things that you're already hearing about: social distancing, washing hands effectively. And then, of course, part of that recommendation is planning for yourself, planning for your household, planning for your businesses. Again, the CDC website has resources for people planning as individuals, people planning for community organizations, people planning for their businesses, people planning for, I think that pretty much covers it, right? Yeah, so the last point on here is take care of each other. So there's a lot of things that we can do to help each other out in this type of scenario. Obviously, people tend to think about how can I keep myself protected, my family protected, first and foremost. But there's also things you can do to help keep your neighbors protected. And some of the things that to help keep your family protected, you might not think about. So these are the recommendations you're hearing, like encouraging people who might be more vulnerable in your friends, family, circles to take extra precaution. And you can help out with that, right? Like if you have an uncle who has diabetes, ask your uncle if you can get the groceries for them. Do the little things that help people who might not be able to meet these recommendations, meet those recommendations. You might have neighbors with kids, and your neighbors might not be able to take off as school closes, but you might be a stay-at-home parent who can handle an extra kid or two. Or same thing for your family. You can make that information known to people through community and neighborhood Facebook sites, all these kinds of things. So super worth taking a second to think about not just what I can do to protect myself, but what can I do to help people around me protect themselves. Those little things make a really big difference in terms of containing the spread of and slowing down the spread of an outbreak like this. So that's all I wanted to say for this video. Thanks for taking the time. All the best to you in these challenging, interesting times.